likely to get me into more trouble, because we're going to get to the end, to the next section today. It's about husbands. So last week might have got me in trouble with everybody. This one just might get me in trouble at home. I don't know. We're never there yet. Bottom line is, any time I get up and preach a sermon, particularly if it's one that's about, here's where God wants us to be, here's how we're to grow, here's where God's, you know what? I'm never there. And I may get up and I may talk about it, and sometimes it may sound like I'm faking it, at least, that I'm an expert or something like that, but there's never a point where I've ever actually gotten there. And we talk about, you find this all over, it's on the signs, on our bulletins, it's everywhere. We are a community church where we grow together. Because the idea is we're never there, but God is taking us somewhere. And it's a journey we do where we're becoming different, we're becoming more like the people that God has called us to become. So last week, we dealt with a section, and I read a little bit out of 1 Peter chapter 2 and 3 before, and this is kind of the fourth of a series that of sermons that are really about, here's how we handle it when life is really kind of kicking us when we're down. And in very practical ways. First part of 1 Peter, he's dealing with, here is your identity in Jesus. Here's who you are. And you are precious in the sight of Jesus. And then he starts dealing with, but I know it's hard. There are people coming after you. There are people saying hard things about you. There's persecution coming out against you. And so he deals with, okay, persecution, here's how you deal with the government. There's a lot about slavery. And I took that as to bigger things about what work is. We're in a situation that's unavoidable. We cannot get out of it. And things are about, but here's how you deal with it. Then he gets into marriage. Oh man, that's sure. It's anybody who's ever been married, pretty hard. Because it's something we all understand. And we need to understand the Bible in its context. And sometimes it's easy to take a couple verses here and there out of its passage, out of the rest of the Bible, and just kind of look at them in isolation. We need to understand what he's saying about wives and husbands in the context of this whole little bit about your identity is in Christ, but here's how you're going to live it out when times are difficult. Government's persecuting you. Government's really driving you crazy. Be the best citizen you can be and submit to the government. It comes to people saying, you feel like you're working like a slave, literally, for a lot of them. Be the best worker you can be and submit to authorities. And as we looked at those two sermons, we saw that it took time. But because the church submitted to government, submitted to this whole idea of mastering that, they changed the world. Eventually, persecution ended. Eventually, slavery even ended. Because people followed, even though it was counterintuitive, what the Bible said, they submitted to authorities, and they did the best that they could do. Last week, we came to this passage on wives. It's women who were loved by God and have been saved by Jesus. That was a revolutionary idea. And if you missed last week, go back. You can find the sermon on our website. It was actually quite revolutionary what the Bible was teaching, that there was no longer male or female. And the women were allowed to approach God. Women could be part of the religious order of things, which was unheard of in the Roman Empire. We looked at a whole bunch of examples of how that wasn't true in that period of history. And women were converted at a much, much higher rate than their husbands. They ended up changing their families. And they ended up changing the world by being the best wives they could be. puts in the same context as dealing with a corrupt empire and the wrongs of slavery, what do you do? What do you do when there's struggles in the marriage? And women were given respect and an equal standing before God, despite society teaching that no, men need to be completely in charge of everything. And it appealed. A lot of women came to Christ and eventually started to lead men to the gospel. And Peter writes and tells them, don't flaunt that. Don't let it turn to arrogance. That's not how Jesus handles things. We are to be like Jesus and to bring love and compassion. This is hard. We've seen this over and over again. As we go through the Bible, bring love and compassion to those who have not earned it, to those who have not deserved it, to where it is hardest to bring. He talks about Jesus being willing to do anything for us, and now he turns his attention. Okay, so wives, you're going to have to do that. Now he's going to turn his attention the other way, husbands. Husbands. And he writes a lot less to husbands. And I said that's because probably there were a lot more women that he was writing to. It's not so much he's picking on women. In fact, if anything, he's going to go the other way. And it's hard because we all know the marital issues are real. They're tough. It is sometimes really hard to love your spouse. I get it. But it's still the command of God that we do that. Ran across this week, this writing this week about husbands and wives when the wife gets a cold. And it said, in year one of a marriage, it goes like this. Sweetie, I'm worried. You've got a bad sniffle. I want you to put you in the hospital for a complete checkup. But a year later, it starts turning into, listen, honey, I don't like the sound of that cough. I'm taking you to the doctor right now. And I want you to go to bed as soon as we get home. By year three, it's, maybe you better lie down, honey. There's nothing like a little rest if you're feeling bad. I'll bring you something to eat. By year four, it's, look, dear, be sensible. After you've fed the kids and washed the dishes, you better lie down. Year five, it's, why don't you just go take a couple of aspirins? By year six, would you please gargle something? You're barking like a seal and I can't hear the TV. By year seven, for heaven's sake, stop sneezing. What are you trying to do, give me pneumonia? Hopefully that's an exaggeration, right? Peter 3:7, husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives. Dressing men. First of all, women, this is how you're going to change the world. Men, your job is just as earth changing. In all ways, it's almost be complimentary. Women can bring their unbelieving husbands to faith, or they can bring their husbands who are of less faith to greater faith. By way of gentle spirit, by not giving their husbands a hard time, but by loving and supporting them. Many of the husbands of those wives who got that message had no interest in hearing what Peter had to say. They didn't want to know. They weren't interested in this. But for those who did, you have a critical role changing things. It's not an easy role. Now next week, we're going to give a little bit of a survey. We're going to step aside from just 1 Peter for a week. Just because we're dealing with something that's kind of critical here in marriage, we're going to do kind of a little bit more of a longer, bigger look at kind of what the Bible has to say about marriage as a whole. But here's just 1 Peter. Men are called to sacrifice. Peter has very intriguing language here. And this is the first of 4 phrases that I want to look at in looking at this 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. So understand, maybe really the beginning here. It's very interesting. As you live with your wife, some translations have it as you live together. Something like that. The way that's phrased is actually kind of different. A Well, of course, husband and wife, they live together, right? They're under the same roof and things like that. But you know what? In Roman society, they may have been under the same roof, but they did not live together. This isn't about physical. This is about doing life together. Because in that society, men and women went off and did their own lives. Men went out, they worked, they went for entertainment, they went out with the boys all the time. Women stayed at home, gossiped with maybe the neighbors occasionally, but stayed at home. Didn't see each other a lot. Right away, there's an emphasis in here in a way that is different, in a way that is counter to their society. Live together. You're going to do this together. And we're going to come, as we go through this passage, even finding your co-heirs with Christ. We're together with this all throughout eternity. You might as well start now. This was something that was not like the ancient world. Live together. Same household, but hugely different rules. I'm saying we're going to focus mostly just on what Peter has to say. Paul, however, I want to just catch this for a second. In Ephesians, he has it a little bit different because he references Christ in the church. What are the he says it's like the relationship between husband and wife is like the relationship between Christ and the church. What's the relationship between Christ? It's a relationship, for starters. It's one that sacrifices. Be considerate. Husbands, be considerate. Be compassionate is one way to translate this. Maybe the best word to translate this, though, is husbands, in the same way, have good manners. Almost do it like that. Have good manners. Be nice. Have polite, helpful. Maybe even a touch of chivalry. Next week, if you haven't quite figured out, is Palm Sunday. I asked the kids in Sunday school, in my Sunday school class, so they knew what Palm Sunday was, and they all kind of got it. They nailed it. It was great. Jesus rides into Jerusalem on a donkey with everybody waving palm branches and then placing the branches at his feet. Why? Because there's an Old Testament prophecy that says that the king will ride into the holy city on a donkey. And he's completing this prophecy, and it's one of the few places in his life where Jesus claims majesty, where he claims royalty, where he claims kingship. The important one rides in the donkey. What's happening with the disciples? They're all around him. He's up, elevated, sitting on the donkey. Animals like that were not common. They didn't ride a lot of horses in particular. They certainly didn't ride a lot of donkeys. It was a sign of power. If you were traveling as a family and you had a donkey, I like how Jesus came in. The husband always rode the donkey. The wife followed behind. In fact, that is still true in a lot of cultures today. You will still find that in a lot of Africa, the Middle East, Asia. Used to certainly be true even in European-type cultures. Why? Because the husband was proclaiming, look how important I am. That kind of flies in the face of what Peter is trying to say here. It elevated the husband, made him feel royal. Master of the house. Powerful. It's not God's way. We're not to elevate ourselves. That's not God's pattern of doing things. Instead, treat the other nicely. Find out what she likes. Do things like that. Make her feel loved. Treat her special. That's the idea here. And it was not the way it was done in the ancient world. Previous verse, we find, if we go back to verse 6, that God calls women precious. That is how men are to treat women. That's the bottom line. It's about how we treat. Tell her continually that she is loved, even where it's hard. In fact, especially when it's hard, because it means more at that moment, right? Tends to change our hearts. Next phrase in this verse goes, and treat them with respect as the weaker partner. Now, this verse does not sound particularly politically correct, does it? But I'm going to tell you, when we look at its context, it actually probably is one of the most politically correct phrases in the Bible, according to the year 2017. Believe it or not. Because we tend to focus just on that word weak, as a weaker partner. Strength equaled value. Strength equaled value. Now, we have a little bit of a different opinion today, right? You know, there's bullying and something like that that gets everybody's upset, and that's a kind of a buzzword these days that gets everybody. In the ancient world, you got bullied? Well, maybe that'll teach you to be tougher. And the bully is the hero. You go through the mythology of ancient Greece and ancient Rome? Absolutely. It's whoever's strongest, whoever can beat everybody up, that was strength. That was great. If you can bully and abuse someone, that is just fine. And you know what? That makes you the better person in their eyes. It was actually quite distasteful, even to the point that the Bible from the very beginning is going to condemn how Roman society treated strength in a marriage. I want to read a little passage. This is definitely not the Bible. Okay? This is somebody named Valerius Maximus, who wrote a book not long before Jesus came around, and basically in which he spent the whole time saying, man, we got to get back to the good old days. We got to get back to the olden times when things were better. And that was kind of always the cry of ancient Rome. Let's get back to the way that our ancestors founded the city. And he comes up with this passage about a gentleman from long ago. Ignatius Mecenas, try to say that fast, beat his wife to death with a club because she had drunk some wine. And not only did no one bring him to court because of this deed, but no one even reproached him, for all the best man thought that she deserved the punishment for example of intemperance. For assuredly, any woman who desires to drink wine immoderately closes the door to all virtue and opens to all vices. The reason why he brings up that little bit about court was, technically, for a man to abuse his wife to the point of death, he technically needed the in-laws' permission. Then it was legal. Yeah. That's the culture in which the Bible is written. We need to understand that. It was actually legal because you didn't want her to embarrass you. You think the Bible had to deal with this in this way? We don't always like this, treat them with respect as we can press some. But he's saying, okay, if your wife, if you can, just because you can beat up your wife, doesn't mean you should. In fact, it's wrong. That is exactly what he's saying. We look at it, and some people get all bent out of shape out of the weaker partner. He's actually, I told you, this is actually the politically correct thing in the Bible. Much of the Bible isn't politically correct, but this one is. Don't beat your wife is basically the bottom. Just because you can doesn't mean that's what God wants you to do. It's actually very strong wording here. If you're weaker, you can physically dominate. That's not the way that God wants it. And the word that's used here is it's kind of like not weak in the sense of being fall apart, but almost in the sense of fine china. You know, you don't use a fine china because you're always scared to break it, but actually it can be surprisingly tough, can't it? That's actually the wording that he uses. honor, respect her. And as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life, I put in the outline on the back of the bulletin, on par for this section. I remember a couple of years ago, the Canadian dollar and US dollar were at par for a little while. And hey, all of a sudden we could afford to go to the States and buy things from there. Equal, but different. Equal, but different. Canadian dollar and the US dollar were never the same, but they were worth the same amount, for at least for a little bit. As heirs with you of the gracious gift of life. Women in the Roman society were heirs of nothing. But in Jesus, the God of the universe, the sovereign of everything, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, co-heirs. Heirs with you, same everything. The ultimate sovereign has called you to reign with him. Not just men. This is not about gender, but both. You're going to disrespect somebody who's a co-heir of the sovereign God of the universe? That's how we're to look at each other. And this isn't just about marriage. This is how we should look at each other. The King of kings, the Lord of lords, has called us to a remarkable place in his kingdom. To reign with him throughout eternity. We treat somebody else poorly? We disrespect somebody that the God of the universe has placed that much respect on? It's almost how dare we. Sometimes you may want to put this up and say, oh yeah, this gift of life, this being heir, oh, that's some eternity thing. Something that will happen someday. And no, he's saying, you know what, we are heirs changing the world now, because we just finished all this about life. You're going to change the world, wives. If you act as Christ has called you to act, you're going to change the world. And they did. They did. It was wives through whom the Roman Empire changed. It was through them spreading the gospel by the way that they lived that changed the Roman Empire forever, that brought about Christianity as the dominant religion. Man, you're going to disrespect that? You're going to disrespect the one that really is changing the world? Men and women are partners in bringing the gospel. And by working together, we can do that. We may have different roles, but we work together to bring the gospel. Because really, this is the point of it. Last time I said, well, so why would women get married? It's going to be the same answer for men according to this passage in 1 Peter. It's because working together, we can change the world. God's greatest purpose of marriage is to bring the gospel out first in our own lives and then in the world around us. And a marriage that is based on God's way of doing things will make a positive influence on this world. But then there is a big warning at the end. So man, what happens if you don't treat your wife well? So then nothing will hinder your prayers. That's interesting. I've read, as I was getting ready for this, all sorts of books that kind of almost change what this is actually saying. Oh, it suddenly becomes, oh man, you should also pray for your wives or something like that. That's not what it says. We don't do what we went in the rest of the verse that says that our prayers will be hindered. Prayers will be hindered. We had a vehicle when we first got married, Zoe and I. It was a little vehicle that you know, if we had tried to sell it, we might have got a whole dollar for it. If you really push down on the accelerator hard enough on the highway, it could sometimes even get up to 90 kilometers an hour. I think it had a whole horsepower. It was pretty sure our lawnmower had more power than it did. But it had this goofy little thing, and I don't know exactly why it was designed this way. It must be designed in some tropical country, I'm sure. Because the gas line was actually exposed to the elements. And when it got to 40 below, and you got on the highway or to a place where you're getting a little bit of wind chill on it, all of a sudden, you would feel, it didn't matter how hard you were pushing on the accelerator, you could just feel the power dropping. And it was that the gas line would freeze up, and slowly the gas line would ice up, it would get more and more constricted until finally you didn't have any power left. You had to pour some gas line antifreeze in there, wait 5 minutes, it would thaw, and then you could go for another 5 minutes. That time, for a little bit, Zoe was working in Leduc, and we were living on the south side of Edmonton, and sometimes it'd take a long time to get from point A to point B. But it was like that. All of a sudden, you could just feel it, that the power was getting constricted, and it was getting choked off, and there was no power left. You know, that's exactly the image that I think Peter is describing here. When we treat our wives in a poor way, it's like it constricts the spiritual power in our lives. Husbands, if we treat our wives poorly, we are cutting off what God is doing in our lives. Because we're supposed to be growing together, moving together, bringing the gospel forward together. And when we don't do that, it constricts our spiritual lives. And I'm going to tell you, I think there's a lot of men who do not pray because there's too much guilt over the way that they've treated their wife. They don't feel like God is listening because they know they're in the wrong. It should be the opposite. It should be driving us to our knees and saying, God, forgive me. But somehow we just don't. Meet a lot of people who say, hey, you know, got to get back to following the Bible, to following Jesus, to loving the Bible, and yet like to ignore some of these verses. Because we need to live the truths of Jesus in the practical moments of life where it really counts. And we're surprised when our spiritual lives struggle and miss the point that marriage or work or how we interact with the government or the rest of society, all those things are really the bottom line of where our spiritual life is lived. And when we fail to follow God in this way, it constricts our spiritual lives. These verses are highly practical. We find out how much our hearts are swept in the things of Jesus by how much we live for Jesus in these highly practical moments. We need to be husbands, these considerate people. Love our wives, who treat them properly as Jesus would have us treat them, who treat our wives well, and it opens up spiritual realms to us. So I was thinking about what I want Tim and Megan to close with. There was only one hymn that really I thought fit, and it's hymn 546, Trust and Obey. Because really,